So we're now on to the next part of our journey through the spectral cytometry. We need to stain our cells. So I've been working with Oliver for nearly 4 years. You've been at Babraham, and I've learned a lot from Oliver over the years. He's built panels for the Symphony, the Yeti, and now the Aurora. So I know that Oliver today is going to give us all a lot of information, some very useful information to take back to your lab about staining. So I'm really looking forward to your talk. Thank you, Oliver. Don't forget, Skittles for asking questions. If you find a spelling mistake, I'll give you Skittles as well, just because then we can proofread.
Okay. So, yeah, I'm Oliver Burton. I'm a researcher here at the Babraham Institute. I work in one of the immunology labs with Adrian Liston. And I'm going to just talk to you today about a technique that I find to be helpful. And I think that it may improve your cytometry and hopefully save you some money as well. So I think that there are two issues that we tend to avoid talking about in cytometry. One is cost of running these big panels, and the other is reproducibility and batch effects. And so cost is definitely an issue in spectral cytometry. These panels are getting bigger and bigger. Every time we add in an antibody, the cost goes up. Particularly if we're buying new fluorophores, they tend to be more expensive. And so you can get to a pretty high cost pretty quickly. And that can limit what you can do, because if each sample costs more, there's less samples that you can run with a fixed budget. So just for kicks, I had to try to estimate the cost of running a sample with this Cytex OMIP 69. And I got a number well in excess, so £100 per sample. I'm happy to be corrected on that, but I think it's pretty high. So I think that definitely could be an issue for some academic labs. And so I want to talk today about how we go about reducing costs with this technique of overnight staining. And the second issue, batch effects, you know, this is something that affects even experienced cytometrists. So this is something that was, this is human PBMC samples run on a very well validated 25 color panel on the Symphony. Same person, same donors, 4 different batches. Experienced person running the samples, and you get very clear segregation on the TISNI in these different colors by batches. So different color, different batch. You can see that the effects are being read out on individual markers here. We have FOXP3 and CCR4 look quite different between these two experiments. So that's potentially a pretty big issue for people as well. So just before we start off with how the technique works, I want to remind you that antibody staining is essentially a chemical reaction. It's non-covalent, but this is a very high affinity interaction. And so antibody binding occurs following a sigmoidal curve, which means that as we increase the concentration of antibody, we reach a plateau where the specific signal no longer increases. And because this is a sigmoidal curve with a log concentration, what we get is moving from the upper part down a little bit in this plateau, you don't lose much signal, but you reduce the concentration of the antibody quite a lot, orders of magnitude. So if you can reduce your concentration and still retain the specific signal, you'll be saving quite a lot of money. Now there's factors that can change the position of the sigmoidal curve, things like pH and temperature, and also time, which is what I want to talk to you about today. So we tend to think that time of incubation and staining is not that big of an issue with cytometry, because you do get staining really quickly. And we also tend to look at flow data on a logarithmic axis, where small changes like a 2-fold increase in staining won't look like much at all. So the examples here, I'm showing you a mouse splenocytes stained with CXCR5 for 30, 45, and 60 minutes. These are, I think, pretty typical incubation times. And you can see that the staining is going up over time. So it's not really clear whether we've actually labeled all the molecules, even though this is an optimal concentration of antibody for this condition. That's right. So this is a relatively short amount of time staining compared to what I do. And what happens if we increase that staining time even further. So beyond an hour, just leaving the staining overnight, and at 16 hours, 20 hours, 24 hours, what happens is that we actually reach a plateau where the staining index doesn't increase any further, and it doesn't change between those different staining times. So whereas with a 30-minute staining, a small change in the staining time, say your timer goes off, somebody comes up and asks you a question, and you get distracted for 3 minutes, that's a 10% variation in your staining from one time to the next, and you can't fix that. If you have this wide window to work in where the staining is essentially constant, you have much less worry about how the staining is going to be affected by interruptions, failure to set a timer accurately, or the temperature that your samples are at. So in a 30-minute incubation, perhaps you want to incubate the samples at 4 degrees. You put them in the fridge, somebody else comes and opens or closes a bunch of times, the fridge isn't actually at 4 degrees, your samples are warmer. That's going to be much less of an issue if you're leaving samples for 16 hours, the average temperature is going to be more constant. Right, so there's an advantage. The other advantage is, you know, more practical. The cytometers are generally open in the morning because people are planning to run their samples in the afternoon. So it's convenient. I can set the staining, go home, come back and run the samples when I'm not tired. But there's another advantage, which is that when we leave the staining this long, the optimal concentration shifts, and it often shifts quite dramatically. So whereas I need to use a 1 in 50 concentration to achieve the best separation in a short staining of an hour, with the overnight staining, I can drop this down to 1 in 500, so tenfold, and I'm still getting that plateau effect, but I'm actually getting better separation with tenfold less antibody with the long incubation than anything I can get at the higher concentration in a short staining. So it's cheaper and better staining. So how does this translate into saving you money? Well, this is examples of the data that I get in the lab. So we're looking at here on the left, several hundred antibodies, the optimal dilution, how much that costs per stain, and log axis on the left. So the average cost, the median cost drops about fivefold per staining. And then panel costs on the right, what we have is several multicolor panels. And you can see that the cost is both higher and a lot more variable with a short 1 hour incubation than it is with overnight staining. So, should be cheaper, which means that you can run more samples for the same amount of money or just save money. So you should be able to get more data, right? So this is examples of how things look like with panels that have been adapted from a short staining to higher staining, overnight staining. So we've got mouse microglia panel on the left with 31 colors, and the cost went down from almost 13 pounds to about 3 pounds with overnight staining. And then with the human panel, this was originally a symphony panel that was 25 colors, took it to the Aurora with a short 1 hour staining, and then to turn that to overnight staining and drop the cost from almost 50 pounds down to around 5.5 per sample, which means that now if I want to be able to run more colors, I can upgrade that to about 48 on the Aurora and still run it at half the price of the original 25 color panel. And the data are pretty good. So in addition to being able to run more data or cheaper data, sometimes you can actually get better data. And I want to show some examples of how leaving the staining for longer can get you better quality data. So this is particularly true for things like intracellular antigens, where we're trying to get these large antibody fluorophore complexes into intracellular compartments, like the nucleus. So you have a lot of steric hindrance with these big molecules. Diffusion takes a long time, so leaving it longer sort of theoretically makes sense. And this is what we see practically, is that here's an example of mouse sinusites that have been either stimulated or not. We'll look for the intracellular cytokine IL-2 in a 30-minute staining and an internuclear protein FOXP3 transcription factor. And both of the staining indices are going up with the overnight staining protocol. This also works for human. This is not a mouse thing. This is human PBMCs, again, looking at Tregs, identifying them by CD127 and CD25. On the left, the 30-minute staining, that CD25, we're not really able to identify the whole Treg population. And with the overnight staining, we're getting now really pretty decent identification of the CD25 positive, CD127 low population. And that's quantified on the right with the stain indices. Sometimes the effect can be quite dramatic. This is particularly the case for antigens that are low expression or that may be internalized. So in this example, we're looking at CCR7, again in mouse splenocytes. And in lymphoid organs, the constant engagement with the ligands, CCL19 and CCL21, means that the CCR7 can be internalized. So if you're staining for a short stain on the surface of the cell, and this is here, relatively bright fluorophore, basically not getting any staining even on T cells, whereas leaving it longer with overnight staining on the surface, we start to pick it up a bit. But if I'm looking at intracellular antigens, and I almost always am because I look at Tregs, so I stain for FOXP3, I can include the CCR7 in the intracellular staining mix and leave that overnight and then detect the entire cellular pool of CCR7, including the internalized part. So it can be handy if you just want to identify where the protein is expressed. And so that gives you a pretty massive boost in this amount of staining that you get. So this is another example, again, with murine cells, looking at CD3. And CD3, I don't know whether it's just that it's hard to access or that it's mostly inside the cell, but it's, again, pretty difficult to stain for in mouse cells, more so than human. And so with a really dim fluorophore, like BV570, in a short half-hour staining, we don't get adequate separation. We still have a bunch of blurring between the positive and the negative, and this is a gating mark of what we really like to have a yes-no answer. So by putting that staining for longer and putting it overnight, I now get down here with tenfold less antibody, really nice separation. And that means that I could use this fluorophore on this clone, which is available. And so I now have more choices for what I can use in designing my panel, because some of the antibodies that wouldn't normally work are now working. So if I have more choices, that makes the panel design easier. And this is another example of that. Here we're looking at NK cells, which express TBET at a relatively high level, and most of the cells in the spleen don't. In this example, I'm using a half-hour staining for TBET, and then we have NK1.1 on the y-axis, so the cells on the y-axis should all be positive. But at 1 in 10 dilution, so basically the whole staining mix is pink from the BV605, I can't separate out the NK cells, and putting in more antibody only makes the entire population shift up. But if I leave that overnight intracellularly, I do get the staining profile that I want here with the NK cells shifting over. And so that means that I can now use TBET in BV605 instead of having to use it, say, in PE. And that means that PE now can be used for a different fluorophore. So I have better choices, I think, with this technique. Right. How would we go about setting up a panel that you might have already optimized for surface staining and changing that for intracellular? So this isn't magic. You've got to do a bunch of work. So the first step is just titrating everything again under the new conditions. I should point out here that I do my titrations on the target cells, so I'm not just using bulk cells, because if you're using bulk cells, you won't be able to tell your specific signal on the T cells from your non-specific signal binding to myeloid cells. So here we're looking at PD-1, and this is a kind of an extreme example just to illustrate the point. But here we start out with our staining pattern that we're used to on the left with surface staining, looking at Tregs and follicular helper cells and CD4s, and then start that concentration intracellular and overnight and see what happens. And obviously it's non-specific, using way too much antibody, so we need to bring that down. And as we reduce the concentration, that correct staining pattern starts to emerge. And as we reduce it even further, we can recover that correct staining pattern. And so obviously with this one, like I said, it's an extreme example, so you could reduce the concentration pretty massively. You'll also see that, you know, and we have concentrations here where we've lost that specificity. This is also something that happens with surface staining, but you're not usually working with orders of magnitude of excess of antibody the way you would be with a longer staining protocol. So to reassure you that specificity doesn't have to be a huge concern, here's some examples that showing you that specificity is retained with this approach. So this is looking at intracellular cytokines in mouse cells. So we have genetic loss of IL-2 in the CD4 cells, and we're co-staining with TNF. And so we have on the top wild-type cells that are staining with both, and the bottom cells stained overnight for the IL-2. And you know, you can see the IL-2 is basically gone. So anything that's remaining, I would guess, is a few cells that missed the Cre excision. But second example of this, we can do phospho-STAT5, which is basically not present if you don't stimulate with IL-2, IL-7, or IL-15, except maybe a little bit in Tregs where their CD25 is allowing them to capture endogenous IL-2 production. And basically that's what you're seeing, is that you get, with overnight staining, basically no phospho-STAT5 and then nice signal. So we can retain specificity with this method. You do need to check with each clone, but in general you can. There's also some advantages where specificity can be better with this technique. So in the case of brilliant violet conjugates, they tend to interact, and this interaction, this non-specific interaction between the dyes, is concentration dependent. So if you're using way less antibody with overnight staining, those interactions will be reduced. You can see in the bottom left, the CD8 is not leaning in as much to the Ly6G, and then that interaction can actually be abrogated in this example entirely with the brilliant stain buffer being included. And I, in this example, was not able to do that with the surface staining, even by putting in the brilliant stain buffer at the recommended concentration, because this particular interaction is quite bad. So, second example where we have more specificity is looking at myeloid binding. So here we have two PE-Cy5 conjugates. So this PE-Cy5 tandem is notorious for binding off-target, non-specifically, particularly to macrophages and monocytes. So what we're looking at here is F480 macrophages, and so all of the signal here is non-specific. This is looking at NK1.1 and TCR-beta, neither of which is expressed on macrophages. And on the top, we have this NK1.1, and the bottom is the TCR-beta. By reducing concentration tenfold with the overnight staining, I get better separation on the target cells. So staining is brighter, and there's less staining on the macrophages. This is probably, I'm guessing, because we actually have less excess antibody floating around, so more of it sort of gets used up binding to the target. I'm not really sure, but functionally it works. And one additional advantage is, besides being able to get better separation for the gating, you won't have excess fluorophore, in this case PE-Cy5, which is a marker that causes a lot of spread. You won't have that bound to a bunch of cells that don't need to have it bound to it, which would cause extra spreading in your panel. So here's a couple examples now looking at how this translates into batch effects. So I hinted at the beginning that what you see with individual markers is more stability, because you get that plateau effect and you have less chance of variation in how your staining works. So the way this translates, as far as I can tell, into a panel is that each of the individual marker adds up and you get greater stability in the equilibrium that the panel reaches. So you achieve more similar staining between different batches. So first we're going to look at human data. This is SIGLAC-8 and CD123. So first off, you can see that with the longer staining example, we get brighter staining, as I've shown you before, but also the variation between the replicates, and this is the same donor run three times, is tighter in the 16-hour versus the 30-minute staining. And when we look at this on a TISNI plot, looking at the entire panel here, we can see that across the top, so again, same donor, same person running the experiment, three different runs, same machine and everything. All of this variation that we're seeing in the Tisney plots, where regions are missing, like the green or the brown, or this red blob that's missing in 30 minute on the bottom right, all that's false technical variation that's been induced by batch effects. When we do the overnight staining, the Tisney plots visually are a lot more similar. And we can quantify this similarity and distance between the samples using a cross-entropy test that a bioinformatician, Carlos Roca, developed for us. And so using this cross-entropy test, looking at the differences in the distributions of the cells between the original data and the Tisney, we can say that there's a trend for a greater distance between the samples in the 30-minute versus the 16-hour. It's only three replicates, so it's not statistically significant. But it suggests that what you're seeing visually is correct, that you have more closeness between the replicates, less batch effect. And so just to drive this point home, here's an example of mouse data. This is four separate experiments that were collected over a period of 2 years. And yeah, you can see that there's some differences in where the cells are distributed on the Tisney, some missing areas in the red, but they're relatively similar. And what we can see when we run the statistical testing on this is that there's actually more variation between the different samples than there is between different batches. So that means that there's more variation between individual mice, biological variation, than there is batch variation. And yeah, that's my talk today. I hope that I've convinced you this might be worth checking out. We'll put together a paper on this that'll be coming out in Current Protocols in Cytometry soon, so there'll be more details there. I just want to say thanks to everybody that worked on this. Most of the human data was done by Teresa Prezzamolo and Carly White. James and Adrian run the lab where I work in, so I really want to thank them for the support and giving me the time and resources to develop this technique. Thanks to all the funders that supported our work, and to the Flow Corps and the animal unit here for helping me out.
Thank you very much, Oliver. Do we have any questions for Oliver? Straight.
So, Oliver, do you have any recommendations around, like, for instance, if you were using an activating antibody in that setup, would you use your staining and then add the activating antibody at the end so you're not causing any cell activation in the process that might change your expression? Or what are your thoughts on that?
So by activating antibody, you mean something like a CD3 binding antibody that would cause TCR or CD19?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
So I don't think you should get any activation if you're staining at 4 degrees, which is what I generally do. Most of the examples I've shown you are also staining post-fixation, mm-hmm. which I would recommend if you can, because you can do the viability staining, fix, and then everything is stable. You don't have to worry about that, and you also don't have to worry about tandem breakdown from fixation.
And one other question. So I've definitely seen, I haven't necessarily done the 16-hour staining, but I have seen improvements if I do, for instance, the nuclear permeabilization, you know, overnight and then do that staining. Have you done comparisons of doing that versus just your staining? Does that make sense, what I'm asking, I guess?
To see if it's a permeabilization effect versus a staining effect?
Yeah.
I haven't directly tested that. Okay. I do know that this increase in staining that we get happens if you've permeabilized the cells or not, mm-hmm. For most antigens. Some of the examples, like I showed you, like the CD3 and CCR7, you need to be inside the cell as well, but you do get an increase. So it is, I think probably you're right that there is an aspect of better access to different cellular compartments by extending a permeabilization, but it can happen just surface staining.
Really interesting.
A question over here.
Sorry. Part of my question was about permeabilization, but the other thing is about temperature.
Yep.
So you do overnight 4 degrees, the room temperature 37. And the other thing is the specificity of the antibodies, you know, monoclonal versus polyclonal antibodies. So have you also, because it's kind of complex,
it's not that simple.
I know.
Mostly I use monoclonals, so those are quite well defined. I have done this with polyclonals. If I'm using a polyclonal, I will use blocking from the host species. But In general, I don't use polyclonals with high parameter panels.
All of your optimization with dilution factors and time was all done at room temperature?
4 degrees.
You see, the 30 minutes, yeah. The majority of the people in my unit, if you do 30 minutes an hour, they'll do room temperature.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just had a case yesterday where I'll do room temperature yeah. for 1 hour instead of doing 4 degrees for 4 hours or 6 hours, things like yeah. that. And
so the overnight works better if at room temperature compared to an hour at room temperature as well, that this holds at room temperature. I don't do room temperature at 37 because I don't want the cells active, and there's variation in what room temperature actually is that I don't want to introduce into my samples. That's personal preference. But the staining does work overnight at room temperature.
Thank you, very interesting. I have a question regarding viability of the cells. Do you do yep. something to keep them alive? Do you see a lot of dead cells?
So, yeah, this is a question we get asked a lot, and I have quantified this. As long as your preps are high viability to start with, you don't actually lose viability much overnight. So if I have like 99% viability at the start, I'll have 98% viability at the end. You can use cell culture media if you want. That will help a bit. The only cells that I see that are negatively impacted by incubating for long periods without fixation are Tregs. So things even like neutrophils don't seem to be that poorly affected.
Do you have experience with plasma cells?
No, I have looked at B cells, but plasma cells are pretty rare in the samples that I work with, so I have not looked at those.
Thanks.
Are all the fluorophores stable enough for overnight staining, particularly the tandems?
So for tandems, I think that there's actually generally an advantage, provided you're keeping the samples cold, because you won't have to expose them to fixative, and you can wrap it in foil. But obviously, you'd want to treat your controls the same way. It's a good question because, I mean, the tandem breakdown is catalyzed by cells in part, so it is something you have to watch out for. But I haven't seen big issues with that.
Can I ask a quick question whilst moving the microphone, Oliver? Do you have to titrate the FC block and the anti-cyanine and the...
I've never titrated the FC block, but we make it in-house, so...
Okay.
I just use an excess.
I was going to ask about the FC block, actually. Like, do you extend your period of blocking when you are going to do overnight?
No, but I include FC block in the staining.
So with all the mix of the antibodies at the same time and leave it overnight?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I generally recommend doing a pre-block as well, but I always include it in the staining.
Okay.
It doesn't hurt. Doesn't make much of a difference for T cells, to be honest.
Sorry, just one more practical aspect then. So if you do a surface staining and then fix and permeabilize and afterwards stain intracellular, obviously we would like to finish after 1 day, I guess. So what is your solution to that? Do you then try to have only one incubation period, or how do you handle if you have more than one incubation period?
So I think typically what we end up doing is a short staining for viability. And maybe there's one or two markers where you need to have it on surface because they're affected by fixation. So CD69 in mice is an example of that. The epitope gets pretty destroyed by any fixative. And then fix and then stain everything else intracellularly overnight or without intracellular permeabilization, just overnight.
And you don't see that the permeabilization buffer somehow affects your surface staining for some markers?
Well, in my case, I'm not really doing much surface staining.
Okay.
So a question about the monocytes. Have you also tried to look at the monocytes? Because those are also somehow sensitive, and the distribution will change if you incubate those cells for a longer time.
So most of the viability testing I have done has been on mouse cells, because I'm primarily working with mouse, it's harder for us to get human samples. I know from the limited experience I have with human samples that you can get viable monocytes. It doesn't seem to be a huge issue. But I think there, it's going to be dependent largely on the viability of your cells if you're doing freeze-thaw cycles.
The second question is about the effect of the temperature also. Have you tried to incubate first for overnight and then start the staining? I mean, the effect of the temperature.
Oh, yeah. I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
I have not tried that, no.
Okay.
That's a good question.
Oliver, over here. Great talk. I think it potentially has a lot of impact for the whole field. But what you're showing, I was waiting for your butt, like, something is, like, it was all very good news. Are you testing a lot on different organs? You know, you do a lot of T-cell biology, but I'm wondering, like, indeed with the viability, like, the if you prep intestinal cells, and there's a lot of, there's way more dead cells there. What would be the impact there? Do you have examples where you...
My standard workflow with mouse cells is, and human, is to do a short surface staining for viability, maybe one or two surface markers, fix, and then stain everything else. So you don't have to worry about viability in that setting any more than you would with a normal setting. If you want to do overnight staining without fixation, the prep quality really matters. So if you're talking about lamina-propria leukocytes, yes, it really matters what the quality is. If you have lower viability, 50 to 75%, you're gonna see that tank if you don't fix. They're adding in cell culture media rather than staining in PBS, BSA, or PBS-FCS will help, but I wouldn't recommend that for tissue preps. We do a lot of tissue preps from all different tissues, and my recommended, if you can do it, is short staining, mark which cells are viable, fix, and then stain for everything else.
All right, thanks.